And part two of True Tilda is next Sunday at 5:15 here on BBC One.
We're back with a new series of Animal Hospital from a brand new location, Hampden Veterinary Hospital in Aylesbury. It's a real country practice with patients ranging from pocket-sized pets like this little character here to farm animals and horses. We'll be keeping an eye on Holly, a puppy who really needs to learn some manners, meeting Madonna, that's a duck, and a stray cat whose life hangs in the balance. Join me for Animal Hospital, Thursday, 8:00, BBC One.
Just one particular performance of Alan Bennett's Wind in the Willows had an audience that would have packed this West End theatre to the rafters for 2 whole years. Yeah. Thank you.
The mole had been working very hard all the morning, spring cleaning his little home.
The BBC puts on productions like this every day.
Believe me, my young friend, there is nothing, absolutely nothing, half so much worth doing as simply messing about in boats.
But they couldn't put on these productions if it wasn't for the unique way the BBC is paid for. By you.
Do you mind? Some of us are trying to listen to this.
Sorry.
Now on BBC One, the early evening news with Maura Stewart at 6:20.
The Liberal Democrats threaten legal action to stop television debates with John Major and Tony Blair if Paddy Ashdown is excluded. Mr. Blair welcomes the announcement that the Prime Minister is ready to face him. He says he's been asking for the debates for months. More violence erupts as Albanians try to escape the chaos. European ministers agree to send in military advisers. And victory for Rangers over Celtic puts them on target for a record 9th league title in a row. Good evening. The Liberal Democrats have threatened legal action to stop John Major and Tony Blair holding live television pre-election debates without Paddy Ashdown. And the Scottish National Party say they should be represented in any debate broadcast in Scotland. The Conservative Party chairman, Brian Mawhinney, confirmed today that the Prime Minister would only debate with the Labour leader.
Despite John Major's reception in Bath yesterday, even the most senior and most loyal Tories now concede publicly they're behind Labour. However, they claim a debate with Tony Blair could transform Conservative fortunes. But the party chairman's sticking to the condition that the debate must be two, not three-sided. Broadcasters could find another way of giving Paddy Ashdown a say, he claims. The Prime Minister won't debate with him.
No, we're talking, as far as the British people are concerned, with a choice of two futures, not a choice of three futures, and a choice of two possible Prime Ministers, not a choice of three possible Prime Ministers. So that's the issue.
If Mr. Ashdown is to be excluded, say the Liberal Democrats, they'll take legal action, and they think they have a good case.
If it's going to be a debate amongst the party leaders, it's got to be fair across the whole of the United Kingdom. That means Paddy Ashdown is the third UK party leader. It also means a role for Dafydd's party, the Welsh Nationalists, and for the Scottish Nationalists as well.
The Scottish Nationalists plan a legal challenge too. Any television debate shown in Scotland, they say, must reflect the reality of four-party politics there. Though the Welsh Nationalists would settle for a debate with the Welsh Secretary and other Welsh Party leaders, the Scots take a tougher line.
Any debate broadcast into Scotland during an election campaign must involve the SNP as an equal participant with the other parties. I mean, after all, we're a very strong political force in Scotland. We've got more support than the Tories and the Liberals put together.
We'll address you, Mr.
In the United States, candidates' debates have long been a feature of presidential elections. In the past, they have had a decisive effect, though in recent contests, their impact has been less strong. Nonetheless, Tony Blair says he'd welcome a debate here. If it depends on Paddy Ashdown being included, Labour are quite willing to accommodate him.
How the whole thing's set up are matters for the broadcasters, but so far as we're concerned, we've been pressing for this debate. So we're delighted, and we hope the Conservatives are serious about this and they're not just dithering about again, because we've been pressing for it for months and months.
The BBC say they'd like to stage debates, and they're talking to the political parties. But all broadcasting organisations are bound by law to be impartial between the parties, particularly during elections. It's hard to see how they can legally mount debates under the conditions which the Conservatives are currently stipulating. Some opposition MPs are suggesting that the Conservatives are bluffing. The Tories don't really want a debate, they claim, so they're setting impossible conditions. It's more likely, perhaps, that they're staking out an opening position at the start of some very tough negotiations. David Walter, BBC News, Westminster.
The former Conservative MP Alan Howarth, who defected to Labour in 1995, has won the nomination for the safe Labour seat of Newport East in South Wales. The former junior education minister beat three rival candidates in a constituency ballot.
And therefore, I declare that Alan Howarth is the candidate.
A seat at last for Alan Howarth on his third attempt. The decision in Newport East followed 2 weeks of fierce campaigning on his part and 18 months in an increasingly uncomfortable spotlight since his defection to Labour.
I'm very, very, very grateful, very proud that they have decided to give me their backing, but there's no question that it was their personal choice, and any one of them will tell you that it was.
So time to get on with the job now?
Absolutely. There's a terrific task to be done. We've got an election campaign to fight, so as far as I'm concerned, I'm pawing the ground and getting ready to go.
Newport East, a traditional working-class steel-making town, was always going to be a tough constituency for a former Conservative to convince. Some local people were suspicious of the part Mr. Howarth played during the 1980s miners' strike. There were allegations, too, that Tony Blair had promised a safe seat in return for defection. The presence of the shadow Welsh secretary today didn't dampen that speculation, but he denied Mr. Howarth had received special treatment.
It's been a perfectly fair, a perfectly democratic process. It's been appreciated, I think, by the electors. And the early talk about candidates being imposed or parachuted in was entire speculation without any substance whatsoever.
But one local Labour activist who failed to get on the shortlist predicted Mr. Howarth could now find it difficult to fit in.
I wouldn't have thought that Newport East has got much in common with Stratford-upon-Avon, and I wouldn't have thought that the people in Newport East have got much in common with the background of Mr. Howarth. So I would have thought he would find it very difficult to fit in.
Tony Blair's propaganda coup of netting a defector has been dampened by the problem of what to do with his catch. Today's decision solves that and also sends out better signals to any other wavering Tories considering the same path after the election. Carolyn Quinn, BBC News in Newport East.
The European Union is to send a team of police and military advisers to help the Albanian government restore law and order. But foreign ministers who've been meeting over the weekend have ruled out sending a military force. Today, the Albanian capital, Tirana, has remained calm despite a big demonstration there. But in the nearby port of Durrës, there were chaotic scenes as thousands of Albanians tried to escape the country by sea.
Would-be refugees waiting for their ship to come in, a ship to take them away from the anarchy of Albania. But it never arrived, and for these young Albanians here in the port of Durrës today, despair quickly turned to violence. Armed police fired over their heads to keep back the crowd, but there were casualties.
Aman!
Some Albanians will risk their own lives and those of their loved ones to escape this nation of poverty and political mayhem. One of those injured told me he cannot bear to stay. There's war here, he said, and there's no bread. My wife and my children have nothing to eat. We watched one Albanian forlornly trying to paddle out of his country, while others attempted to sail themselves across the Adriatic to Italy. As for the rest, they're still at the quayside tonight, waiting and hoping.
Even police bullets will not drive these people away from here because they are utterly desperate to leave Albania. They don't care where they go. For them, right now, anywhere would be better than their homeland.
And yet in the capital, Tirana, tension does seem to be easing. Some of the weapons looted over the last few days have been handed in today. At the city's third precinct police station, the captain says guns are coming in, though only a fraction of the tens of thousands that have been stolen. And out on the streets of Tirana, the people who've had enough of looting and shooting wanted to say it out loud. A flower power demonstration to demand a return to some semblance of normality.
We want peace, peace, only peace in our country, Albania.
This may have been a protest instigated by supporters of the beleaguered President Berisha, but it did also seem to be a genuine cry for peace in a terribly troubled land. Ben Brown, BBC News, Albania.
In the past week, more than 4,000 Albanians have fled the country by sea. Most of the refugees, often packed aboard unseaworthy boats, have escaped across the Adriatic to the Italian port of Brindisi. Officials there say they're struggling to cope with the growing tide of Albanians seeking refuge.
The Albanian ship ran aground off the Italian coast in the early hours of the morning. It was a potential tragedy, but miraculously, amid the inevitable chaos, all those on board were brought off safely. Once on dry land and under the care of the Italian rescue services, some needed medical attention. With the ordeal behind them, Albania by now must have felt a world away. The police carried out a routine search for weapons and patrolled the coastline looking for any Albanians who tried to slip ashore unnoticed. The Italian Prime Minister, here to assess the situation, says there's no choice. For now, the refugees must be allowed to stay.
Nobody can push people into the sea, but we are arranging with all the European Union a big project in order to restore the life, civil, political, and security life in Albania.
The influx of Albanian refugees is stretching both Italian patience and resources to breaking point. Some of those who've arrived by sea are being kept in this warehouse at the local police headquarters, bewildered by the sudden upheaval to their lives.
For me, it's a bad dream. I close my eyes and I don't know where am I?
3-month visas are being granted to Albanians with valid papers. Some have already been allowed to leave the reception centres.
This is what the Italian authorities are having to deal with. Thousands of destitute Albanians in a state of heightened tension. And for the time being, they can only provide very makeshift accommodation. Peter Biles, BBC News, Brindisi.
The father of an 8-year-old girl is to sue Calderdale Education Authority over cancelled lessons. A writ will be issued on behalf of Penny Houghton, who's been missing lessons at Fernieley Primary School in Todmorden near Rochdale because of a dispute over class sizes. Members of the National Union of Teachers are refusing to teach classes of over 30, forcing around 30 children to be sent home from the school every day. The father of the 13-year-old schoolgirl, Caroline Dickinson, who was murdered during a school trip to Brittany, is calling for a widespread program of DNA testing. Caroline was killed last July as she slept in a youth hostel in Plaine-Fougère. Her father, John Dickinson, who's just visited the village, wants tests on every man living in the area to keep the pressure on the police investigation. King Hussein of Jordan has travelled to Israel to visit relatives of the 7 schoolgirls shot dead by a Jordanian soldier 3 days ago. The king is also meeting the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to discuss their differences over Israel's plan to build a new settlement in the occupied East Jerusalem.
King Hussein was at the controls when his plane arrived in Tel Aviv. Even before one of his soldiers killed the 7 schoolgirls, relations between Israel and Jordan were the worst they've been since they made peace in 1994. The king left for the town of Beit Shemesh, where the girls lived, with Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. Last week, before the murders, the king wrote to him to say Israel's policies were pushing the Middle East towards an abyss of bloodshed and disaster. The king visited the homes of all the girls and was greeted with the traditional bread and salt. The mother of Sivan Patihi said she wished he could have come when her daughter was alive, because if he had seen her smile, he would have hugged her. She welcomed him and praised his humanity. Prime Minister Netanyahu translated. Sivan's father said he had been to Jordan and had walked its streets without fear. In Arabic, this man told Hussein that he was the king of peace, and not just the king of Jordan, but the king of Israel as well. Adi Melka's parents, brothers and sister were sitting on the floor, which is the custom for bereaved Jewish families. It was all too much for Adi's mother, who fainted.
I feel that I've lost a child.
But despite this visit, the peace process is still in deep crisis. Mr. Netanyahu seems intent on building the new Jewish settlement on occupied land in Jerusalem. Both Palestinians and Israelis repeated today that they expect violence when the bulldozers start work.
King Hussein has won new respect among Israelis. A lot of them admire the gesture he made today, but it will take much more hard diplomatic work for Israel to rebuild a relationship of trust with the Palestinians and the rest of the Arab world. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, Jerusalem.
A pilot was killed this morning when his helicopter crashed in Hertfordshire. The aircraft burst into flames when it came down in a field near the village of Albury soon after takeoff. The pilot from Spalding in Lincolnshire was the only person on board. He hasn't yet been named. Tens of thousands of demonstrators have marched through Brussels, calling on the European Union to do more to protect jobs. Workers from all over Europe, including Britain, were also protesting against the effects of policies aimed at creating a single European currency.
The trigger for today's protest was Renault suddenly closing its factory here last month. But the huge turnout in the heart of Brussels is the result of mounting unease with the European Union and its direction. 3,000 Renault workers were laid off without warning, and today the shell of a Renault car bore the brunt of their frustration. European laws were meant to protect them. Instead, the EU is seen to have let them down.
The Union of Europe, it's only good for the rich, not for the workers. That's why I'm here.
This wasn't just a Belgian protest. Demonstrators came from all over the continent and even from Britain to press the EU to think less about its own reforms and more about jobs.
We want not only Europe for capitals, Europe for markets, but also Europe for workers, Europe for wages, Europe for growth, and Europe for social progress.
This was the second giant demonstration here in 6 months. The first was about protecting children from paedophiles. This one's about protecting employees from the effects of the single currency.
We want a Europe for the workers. We want that it will be focused not only on the currency, but that it will be focused on social Europe.
It's ironic that here in the supposed capital of the European Union, one of the targets of this huge protest should be European policies. It's a warning to the EU that as the single currency approaches, public support, even here, is far from guaranteed. David Shookman, BBC News, in Brussels.
Football now, and in the Old Firm derby, Rangers beat Celtic 1-0 at Parkhead. Brian Laudrup's goal has put the champions in a strong position. They're 8 points clear of their nearest rivals with just 6 games to play.
A last Old Firm derby for Richard Gough, which began well for his side. Brian Laudrup's break from midfield setting up Ian Durant, whose finish was weak. Celtic's best moment of the first half came from a free kick. Tosh McKinley providing the flick for Di Canio, who dipped the ball onto the bar. The goal came just before half-time. Defensive indecision by Celtic let in Ian Durant. His cross shot bundled in by Laudrup. In the second half, the contest became more physical. Mark Hatley's headbutt on Celtic keeper Stuart Kerr led to the 35-year-old's departure. Mookie Mackay followed minutes later for a second bookable offence. Anoni came close to levelling the game in the last 5 minutes, but in the end, Celtic were a spent force. After the final whistle, some of the players were clearly upset, but it doesn't change the fact that Rangers should now have few problems taking a record 9th title. Nigel Gainsborough, BBC News.
In the Premiership, Chelsea have beaten Sunderland 6-2 at Stamford Bridge. The Italian Gianfranco Zola opened the scoring for Chelsea. It was his 10th goal of the season. Frank Sinclair, Dan Petrescu, Robert Di Matteo and two from Mark Hughes also added to the tally. And the main news this evening, the Liberal Democrats have threatened legal action to stop John Major and Tony Blair holding television debates without Paddy Ashdown. That's it for now. The late news tonight, 10:15.
fed up sitting in traffic jams? Well, in 8 years' time, you'll dream of moving this fast. In 8 years' time, man's love affair with the motor will end in messy divorce. We call it gridlock. And what are the politicians going to do about it? Build fewer roads and charge you more for your motoring pleasure. Tomorrow night, why you might think about selling your car. Panorama, tomorrow, 9:30, BBC One.
Good evening to you. Well, most parts of the country have again been very mild today. Temperatures well into double figures, but it's been a different story across Shetland, where temperatures have barely been up to freezing and it's been snowing for much of the afternoon. But as you can see, the rain and drizzle elsewhere across Scotland has been petering out over the past few hours, as the weather fronts, which are lying up there at the moment, are going to become very weak for the next 24 hours, and then tomorrow we'll find them pushing north again, if anything. That eventually will introduce some milder conditions for Shetland. It'll take a long time, temperatures perhaps tomorrow afternoon about 5 degrees there. But the high pressure holding firm in the south, that means pretty light winds for many of us. That could bring some mist and fog problems across the southern parts tonight. Elsewhere, too much breeze, a good deal of cloud too, just a few gaps appearing on the eastern side of Scotland. Temperatures perhaps at the lowest about 5, otherwise a pretty mild night. And then tomorrow, sunshine difficult to come by first thing. Certainly very gloomy around the southern and western coast, but eventually we'll find some brighter weather breaking through in the shelter of the Welsh mountains perhaps, and in north-east England. And then temperatures should reach about 14, that's 57 Fahrenheit.
Yvonne!
While Yvonne's away, Gary can play.
Nothing's going to spoil this holiday, Gary.
Stressful things, holidays.
She's coming home next week.
I'm going to be on holiday 5 decades ago.
With your pregnant lover.
Just you and me and a week of glorious weather.
Pretty summertime. Goodnight, sweetheart. Tomorrow, 8:30 on BBC One.
Songs of Praise comes from Sheffield Cathedral with Michael Burke here on BBC One in 5 minutes.
And now the headlines from the Look North newsroom this Sunday evening. A right to education, the parents fight for their daughter's schooling. And the river tragedy, police recover a man's body from the air. Hello, good evening to you. The parents of an 8-year-old girl from Calderdale are to sue education chiefs over cancelled lessons at her school. It's the latest crisis to hit the beleaguered education authority, which hit the headlines last year over the closure of the riding school in Halifax.
Pupils at Fernley Lee Primary in Todmorden have had lessons cancelled because members of the National Union of Teachers are refusing to hold classes with more than 30 pupils. Penny Houghton and her classmates have been sent home twice since the dispute began a fortnight ago. Speaking at the start of the action, the child's father says it's placed an unfair burden on parents and pupils alike.
No notice, any morning, come and get them. Or they'll get a letter the night before, no school tomorrow, which is quite unbelievable, really.
The row at Fernley Lee follows a vote of no confidence by primary headteachers in the way Calderdale is running its schools. Meanwhile, the NUT and education chiefs meet tomorrow to try and restore full-time education at the school and so avert further legal action.
A man's been killed in an accident at a factory at Immingham in North Lincolnshire. The man was working at the Meldon fabrication plant when a metal frame fell onto him. He died at Grimsby Hospital. It's believed the man's from Scunthorpe and is married with 3 children. The body of a man in his early 20s has been recovered by police divers from the River Aire in Leeds. It's believed the man fell into the river at about 2:30 this morning. He'd been out with family and friends.
Police divers were out at first light searching the waters of the River Aire. Using tanks of compressed air, they trawled the riverbed for any trace of the missing man. But it was several hours before they discovered a body.
Approximately 11:30 we found the body of a male person, about 50 or 60 metres downstream from the road bridge. From the clothing that he's wearing, it would appear to be the same person that we've been looking for.
It's understood the man had been out with family and friends when he and another man fell into the river. The second man managed to cling to the bank until he was rescued. The accident doesn't surprise locals, who say that part of the river is a death trap.
There's been several cases where people have actually fallen in the river or been thrown in the river, and once they actually get in the river, there's no way of getting out themselves, because you can see it's actually 3 or 4 feet to actually get up from the river. There's no lifeguards around here and there's no safety precautions.
West Yorkshire Police have begun an investigation into how the accident happened. The results will be passed to the coroner.
The three-month-old baby and her mother, who went missing last week in Sheffield, have been found safe and well. The police said they were concerned for the safety of Shauna Jones, who disappeared with her mother last Monday. The Prime Minister of Azad Kashmir, Sultan Mahmoud Chaudhary, has been visiting Bradford today. He was the guest of the council and addressed a public meeting at the City Hall. Bradford has the highest concentration of people originating from Azad Kashmir outside of the Indian subcontinent. Now the results from this afternoon's Super League games. Here's the details then. Well, Leeds 32, Oldham 22, Salford 4, Castleford 0, Sheffield Eagles 4, Paris Saint-Germain 18 and Wigan 20, Halifax 18. On to Division 1, Featherstone Rovers 32, Swinton 26, Huddersfield 36, Keighley 12, Hull 54, Widnes 6, Wakefield Trinity 32, Whitehaven 10. Now for a look at the forecast for our part of the world. Here's the details. Well, tonight a little drizzle, otherwise dry, rather cloudy, minimum temperatures 7 Celsius. Monday then, dry with some sunny spells and very mild temperatures tomorrow, getting up to 15 Celsius. That's 59 Fahrenheit. The outlook, Tuesday, rain brighter, later and colder. Wednesday, showers or longer spells of rain. Thursday and Friday, sunny spells and wintry showers falling as snow at times. Should be getting better, shouldn't it? Not worse. That's it from us this evening. Join us again tomorrow morning from 6:25 if you can. Bye-bye.
When freedom is close at hand...
We're all right with that one. His old ma's going to keep him in check.
You'll see when you come home next weekend.
Home for your birthday.
Reality sets in.
He'll be out in a few weeks. He needs training, not sitting around all cosy.
But there are some things you can't prepare for.
She was okay yesterday. She's never ill.
Stories from an open prison.
What am I going to do now, Mr. Pine?
Insiders, Wednesday, 9:30 on BBC One.
Pianist's Fingers, the Bombardier Beetle.
I dream I'm an insect. That's actually very weird.
The Square Root of Minus One, Dancing Bees.
I'm into meteorites and I'm into meatloaf.
It's hard to choose the seven wonders from the fantastic world around us.
In a world full of wonders.
I realised that the real world was beyond imagination.
Seven scientists, from Richard Dawkins to Arthur C. Clarke, choose their seven wonders of the world. Part of Science Week, Wednesday at 7 on BBC Two.
Now on BBC One, Songs of Praise with Michael Burke.
Just over a year ago, I was working here in the BBC newsroom when the world was shocked by the terrible events in Dunblane. There seem to be all too many tragedies. Recently, we've had Lockerbie, Rwanda, the Hillsborough disaster. The list seems, and is, I suppose, endless. It's my job as a newscaster and a journalist to report on what's going on, the good and bad events that shape our daily lives. And there isn't a day that goes by without some terrible news somewhere in the world. And I'm often left wondering why they happen. If there is a God that loves us, how can he allow suffering in the world? I don't know. No one knows. But on tonight's Songs of Praise, we meet some remarkable people who've encountered situations that none of us would want to face and have been forced to wrestle with their faith. They don't claim to have the answer either, but maybe they've found some pointers that can help us to make sense of it all. Sheffield is a city with some authority to talk about suffering. On the 15th of April 1989, nearly 100 people were crushed to death in the Hillsborough football stadium. And although the victims were mainly from Liverpool, the fabric of the city was badly scarred, and the healing process is still going on. The cathedral here in the city centre held the Hillsborough Memorial Service. And tonight, with the help of choirs from all over Yorkshire, it plays host to our Songs of Praise.